I will admit, throughout much of the time I spent learning about ancient civilizations as a child, I always just kind of assumed the Greeks were united in their own empire, kind of like most other cultures you tend to learn about. I mean, if Rome, Egypt, Persia, China, and all the rest had singular unified empires, then why not Greece? Although we may learn about all the people, culture, history, and accomplishments of ancient Greece as just ancient Greece, the cities surrounding the Aegean Sea in the first millennium BC were, of course, far from unified. What we call ancient Greece was actually a collection of different city-states, all split apart through politics and wars, yet intertwined through alliances, religion, and culture. So what were these city-states, and how exactly did they function, both from within and from without?
Brought to you by generous supporters on Patreon.
First, let's take a look at what exactly an ancient Greek city-state was. The term polis, plural poleis, is often used as a shorthand for these city-states, as it is the Greek word for city, and indeed what these cities were classified as in their heyday. So that's the term we're going to be going with, purely for simplicity. There were a total of over 1,000 poleis spread throughout the Mediterranean, dotting the coastlines of not just modern Greece and Turkey, but also Libya, Egypt, Italy, France, and many other nearby countries, with some even all the way in Afghanistan. Some of the most well-known of these poleis, though, included Athens, Sparta, Corinth, Thebes, Rhodes, Ephesus, Miletus, Cyrene, and Syracuse. A polis generally encompassed a particular city, the Asti, and also its immediate surroundings, including any farms, harbors, or smaller towns servicing the city, classified as the chora. At the center of the Asti was often a fortified citadel known as the Acropolis. Also, side note, indeed, while we might call this part of Athens the Acropolis, other poleis also had their own acropolises. The one we all know of today is just the Acropolis of Athens. The Asti frequently featured a central agora, temples, gymnasia and theaters, and walls to protect themselves. But buildings alone do not make a city-state. Poleis were effectively independent political entities, with their own governments, either democratic or oligarchic or even tyrannical, their own minted coins, and often even their own colonies. The people of a specific polis were also often granted citizenship within that specific polis, and indeed the concept of citizenship is said to have first emerged among the Greek poleis. The inhabitants of a polis, though, were also separated into different classes. At the top were free men born legitimately to citizen parents, who were entitled with the right to vote, run for office, and bear arms, though they were also obligated to serve in battle. This was only true after the age of 18, though, and their female relatives were a step below, offered full legal rights, but no political rights, as it was the adult male citizen who was supposed to represent their interests. Below them were the metics. Not medics, metics, with a T, derived from the Greek metikoi, meaning trans dwellers, who were basically foreign citizens with full legal and political rights at home, but no political rights in their polis of residence, and might have also had to pay a metic tax. Liberated slaves were also given this status in Athens. Lastly were the non-liberated slaves, who were basically property with no rights whatsoever. All of the Greek poleis had a common Hellenic culture and language, more or less, we'll get to that later, as well as a common religious tradition. However, the people we all collectively label as the Greeks descended from many different Greek tribes, the foremost major of which were the Achaeans, Aeolians, Dorians, and Ionians. In Greek mythology, the tribes were all descendants of the patriarch Helen, spelled with two L's and not to be confused with Helen of Troy, the progenitor of the Greek peoples, and indeed the reason why the people of the Hellenic Republic called their country Elada, and not some variation of Greece or Yunanistan. Helen had three sons, Aeolus, Doris, and Zuthus, the latter in turn having two sons of his own, Achaeus and Ion. And yes, hopefully you can see a pattern here. The Achaeans and Aeolians originated in and around Achaea, or the Peloponnese, and Thessaly in central Greece, though the Aeolians would be largely pushed out into the Aegean Islands, possibly through Doric invasions. A notable example of an Aeolic polis would be Thebes. The Dorians originated from southern and western Greece, and up into Epirus in modern-day Albania, near their close cousins, the Macedonians. Some examples of Doric cities include Sparta, Corinth, Megara, Argos, Pylos, and Olympia. Finally, the Ionians were perhaps the most widespread of the four major tribes, spreading throughout Attica, Euboea, and throughout the Aegean Sea into western Anatolia, or at least the parts not colonized by Aeolians or Dorians. The most well-known Attic Ionic cities included Athens, Ephesus, and Miletus. Inevitably, even the dialect of Greek spoken began to change among the poleis, dividing into a Western, Central, and Eastern group. After the conquest of Greece by the Macedonians, however, and the subsequent conquest of the Persian Empire and Hellenization of its former territories, a common Attic-based Koine Greek dialect was put into use as a lingua franca of the region, as would continue to be used throughout the Roman era. The ancient Greek poleis also frequently went into competition with one another, as humans tend to do, often leading to all-out war. These wars, however, weren't just Athens and Sparta duking it out, but involved complex shifting networks of alliances and treaties, especially once the Persians got involved. By the 540s BC, the Persian Achaemenid Empire had expanded into western Anatolia and later into Thrace, absorbing poleis by the likes of Ephesus, Miletus, Samos, Byzantion, and Pella into their realm. The lead-up to the Greco-Persian Wars is a story for another time, but nonetheless, the Ionian Revolts and the Second Persian Invasion of Greece eventually led to the formation of the Delian League in 478 BC. The members of the military alliance, now known as the Delian League, spanned throughout the islands of the Aegean Sea and western Anatolia, but was effectively led by Athens. Members were expected to swear to hold the same common allies and enemies as the rest of the group, and also pay a tribute in gold, ships, or grain to maintain the naval fleet. The group initially met to discuss matters in the sacred island of Delos, where the group gets its modern name, and where the tributes were stored, at least until 454 BC, when the treasury was moved to Athens, in light of a failed expedition to aid an anti-Persian prince in Egypt. The League had already started to look like a kind of Athenian empire by the breakout of the First Peloponnesian War in 460 BC, followed by a short-lived peace and numerous revolts. These revolts led up to the Second Peloponnesian War in 431-404 BC, between the Athenian-led Delian League and the much longer-lived Spartan-led Peloponnesian League, ultimately ending in the collapse of the Delian League. We should perhaps also mention that only 31 of the Greek city-states actually fought the Persians, with most staying neutral and some even siding with the Persians. Honestly, HBO, if you need something to keep you afloat now that Game of Thrones has ended, make something about all this. On a closing note, this whole setting up independent city-states instead of building an empire thing was not something unique to the Greeks, nor were they even the first to do so. The Phoenicians also functioned somewhat similarly to the Greeks, as their civilization effectively consisted of four large city-states in Lebanon who set up colonies and trading posts all throughout the Mediterranean. In fact, most of the ancient cities of Mesopotamia were city-states as well. And in a way, this kind of makes sense, since maintaining an empire can be a lot more expensive than just maintaining trade and defense agreements with allies, whom you could also dominate and demand tribute from. This may or may not also explain the slow rise of a civilization virtually synonymous to us with huge empires, and yet which spent its first 400 years as just another lowly Latin city-state, Rome.